So welcome to the course on digital communication system. Now to start with, let me tell you very briefly what we mean by any communication environment. Now any communication environment can be thought of as a combination of three different units. The first one is the transmitter block. First one is the transmitter block, which is normally referred by means of this TX. And we have another block named as receiver, which we designate by RX. And in between this TX and RX, there is a channel exist. The role of the channel is to allow the information to get transmitted from the transmitter side to the receiver side. So in a nutshell, we can think that any communication environment can be thought of as a collection of these three different units: transmitter, channel, and receiver. Transmitter will generate some information carrying signal, and this signal will be transferred through channel to the receiver, and at the receiving end, the corresponding signal will be retrieved. Now, depending upon the channel which is existing in between the transmitter and the receiver, there could have been different types of communication environment. Now, if in between the transmitter and receiver some dedicated channel exists, then I can say that this type of communication is known as wired communication. That means the transmitter and receiver, they are connected by means of some dedicated channel, the channel which exists physically. So depending upon the property of the channel, we can have wired communication where the transmitter and the receiver, they are connected by means of some dedicated channel, or you can also have wireless communication, in which case you'll find that although they are not physically connected, but by means of some property of the air medium, the transmission is possible between the transmitter and the receiver. Now, as far as the wired communication is concerned, we can have different types of channel depending upon the signal which you want to convey through the channel. For example, if I consider a very simplest type of signal which is to be transmitted, is nothing but a sinusoidal signal. So sinusoidal signal, for example, if I want to represent the signal, message signal MT, by means of some AM sine of omega MT, where AM is the amplitude of the signal, the peak of the waveform AM, and omega M is nothing but the corresponding angular frequency. So as you know, if this difference is given by T, then the frequency is given by 1 upon T, and omega, or I can also write this like here, that is equal to 1 upon T, and FM is given by 1 upon T, and omega M, the angular frequency, is given by twice by FM. Now for a pure sinusoidal signal, there is only one frequency present. That frequency is given by FM. Now for any other signal, for example, if I consider voice signal or audio signal, so you'll find a lot of frequency present within our audio or voice signal. For example, if I consider the speech signal, then the maximum frequency which can be present within any speech signal is up to 3.4 kilohertz. So we can generate signal up to 3.4 kilohertz. So starting from few tens of hertz to few kilohertz, up to say 3.4 kilohertz. So that is the range. So when we generate some signal, audio signal, then this particular signal consists of a number of frequency components, unlike a pure sinusoidal signal. As you know, a pure sinusoidal signal is a monotone signal. That means it involves only one frequency component. And that frequency component is given by fm, which is equal to 1 upon the time period. Now, depending upon the signal frequency, the channel is accordingly selected. Moreover, there is another important operation which is being performed to establish the communication process, which is known as a modulation. So what do you mean by modulation? So whenever you are making any attempt to transmit the information or transmit the signal from one end to the other end, then what is normally done? The corresponding signal is not transmitted on its own. Rather, there is a carrier signal by means of which the signal is transmitted from the one end to the other end. Now, modulation has some serious resemblance with our travel. For example, if I want to move, or if anyone wants to move from one position to another position, suppose this is my starting position. This is my starting position, and this is my end position. I, being a human being, if I want to move from SP to EP, and if the distance, for example, is only say few hundreds of meters, suppose this is 500 meter, then I can travel by my own. I don't require any other vehicle for that. On the other hand, if the distance between SP to EP, starting position to the end position, suppose it is say few tens of kilometers, like let it be 10 kilometer, then I need to avail some vehicle. I need to avail some bus, or I need to avail some cab for this particular operation. Now, on the other hand, if the distance between SP and EP is, say, for example, few hundreds of kilometers, like say, let it be say 250 kilometers, starting position to the end position, I would like to go from Kolkata to Durgapur. If the distance is few hundreds of kilometers, then it is preferable that you take some train, you avail some train. And if I go even beyond, so if the distance is like few thousands of kilometers or even large, I would like to move from say Kolkata to Delhi or Kolkata to Chennai. So in that case, I can avail either train or I can also avail flight. So I, being the message signal, I, being the information bearing signal, I am traveling from SP to EP, but I am taking the help of some other means. Now, this particular analogy is also applicable for electronic communication, and the method is known as modulation. So in case of modulation, there is a carrier signal, just like our vehicle, and this carrier signal is used to allow us to move from the one place to the other place. So for modulation to take place effectively, there is a carrier signal, high frequency carrier signal. Suppose we have a high frequency carrier signal like this, and the property of this carrier signal is modified with the aid of the information bearing signal. Now, if I consider this particular signal, now it is having three different attributes. One is the amplitude, second one is the frequency, and third one is the phase. Now, either the amplitude or the frequency or the phase of this high frequency carrier signal is modified in accordance with the modulating signal, or in accordance with the message signal or information bearing signal, which I designate by MT. So, accordingly, in continuous wave modulation, we can have three different types of modulation scheme. One is known as amplitude modulation, or AM in short. Then we know what is meant by the frequency modulation, or FM in short, or the phase modulation, or PM in short. So these are the different modulation schemes for continuous wave modulation. So what do you mean by continuous wave? That the input signal is continuously varying, and the carrier signal, which is used in the modulation process, is also analog in nature. It's a continuous wave kind of thing. Now, apart from this continuous wave modulation, there is another type of modulation which is known as pulse modulation. In case of pulse modulation, instead of this high frequency carrier signal, like a sinusoidal signal, a train of pulse is used to carry the information from one end to other end. So it will be acting as our carrier signal for a pulse modulation. Similarly, there are three different attributes of this pulse. One is the amplitude. Second one is the duration of the pulse. That means the difference. Duration means this distance, this one. And second one is the position. Amplitude, duration, or position. Now, whenever there is some information bearing signal present over here, and depending upon the magnitude of the information bearing signal, either the amplitude or duration or position of the pulse is modified. And accordingly, we have different modulation schemes, which are known as pulse amplitude modulation, pulse duration modulation, and pulse position modulation, PAM, PDM, and PPM. So these are all belonging to the continuous pulse modulation or analog pulse modulation. On the other hand, there is another important attribute, another important types of communication which is taking place, which is known as a digital pulse modulation. Now, in case of digital pulse modulation, the information bearing signal is not at all continuous in nature. Rather, it is discrete in nature. Now, before saying anything about this digital pulse modulation, now let me tell you very briefly what we meant by the analog signal, what we meant by the discrete signal. Let me go to the next slide. Suppose the signal is a sinusoidal signal, or I can consider any signal, I don't have any problem. So this signal MT, now with respect to time, it is varying like this. So this is the time axis, and this one is the amplitude axis. So what we find is, for every value of t, there is a corresponding value of mt. So mt is defined for all value of t. In fact, this is continued. So I have drawn only for a single period, so it will be continued forever. So here we find that for every value of t, the signal mt exists. So that's why this type of signal is known as the analog signal or continuously varying signal. So it is analog both in the time domain as well as in the amplitude domain. So what do you mean by the analogous nature in the amplitude domain? That means if this peak value is AM, for example, then the signal value MT can assume any value within the range 0 to AM during the positive half cycle and 0 to minus AM during the negative half cycle. It can assume any value. So along the x direction and along the y direction, both of these variables can assume any possible value within the real number set. So this is an example of analog signal. Then after analog signal, we can have a type of signal which is defined only for two particular time intervals. For example, instead of having MT for all T, if it is defined for some particular T, that means suppose T is equal to 0, we have some MT. Then at T is equal to T1, we have some another MT, that means this value. Then at T is equal to T2, at T is equal to T2, it is defined. T is equal to T3, it is defined. T is equal to T4, it is defined. Then instead of having this MT, now we are having a set of sequences. So now this modified signal, if I want to represent the modified signal by some function, then the modified signal is defined for only for particular values of t, not for all values of t. Then it is known as discrete time continuous amplitude signal. So the first one was continuous time and continuous amplitude. Continuous time and continuous amplitude signal, the first one, the MT. And the second one is known as discrete time. Discrete time, but continuous amplitude signal. So the time is discrete. We have made the time discrete, but the amplitude is still continuous. The value can be anything between 0 to AM or 0 to minus AM in the positive and the negative half cycle respectively. Similarly, we can have the other possibility as well. The continuous time discrete amplitude and the discrete time discrete amplitude. Now, before going into those different possibilities, that continuous time discrete amplitude and discrete time discrete amplitude, first of all, we have to identify or we have to appreciate that whenever instead of having this MT, say MT was the original signal, original information bearing signal, so it can be anything. Not necessarily it is a sinusoidal signal, it can be any signal of some uneven shape. Now, instead of transmitting that particular information, MT, if I convey the same information by means of some samples, then is it possible to retrieve the signal MT at the receiver end? That is an important question to ask in digital communication. So in case of digital communication, the signal is transmitted. The information bearing signal, that means this MT, is represented in a particular form, which is discrete in the amplitude domain as well as in the time domain. So instead of having MT, what we have a sequence of samples. And moreover, these samples are not taken arbitrarily. Rather, there is a particular method or there is a particular value is there based on which we can sample the signal. For example, let me start with any arbitrary signal, which looks something like that. Suppose this is my arbitrary signal. And suppose this signal, let it be GT, which is a function of T. Now suppose this signal is having finite energy. It's a finite energy and it is existing for all T. So GT is existing for all T. So obviously for T less than zero, it is having some value. And for T up to infinite, it is also having some value. Now, in order to represent the GT by means of some samples, so what is done is the value of GT is obtained at some fixed value of T. That means the difference between two consecutive samples is also fixed. This is known as uniform type of sampling. The only condition is that GT is finite energy signal and it is existing for all T. So I have just shown a portion of GT, although it will exist beyond this point and beyond this point. Now, this difference is represented by TS. So we will be taking one sample in every TS second. So what will be the sampling rate? So sampling rate will be 1 by TS. So sampling rate of this particular signal, sampling rate is given by FS, which is equal to 1 upon TS. That means the difference between two consecutive samples is given by TS in the time domain. So the next obvious question that must come into your mind is that, can we select the value of TS arbitrarily? Or is it having some relation with the property of the signal GT? Now this question has been answered long back by famous scientist Nyquist. Now Nyquist has established some theorem by means of which we can basically calculate the rate at which if we sample the signal GT, it will be properly retrieved from its samples. Now these samples, which are present only for fixed value of T, that is NTS. So this is represented by these samples are represented by this sequence of GNTS for all N. So these samples are represented by g of nts for all n, where n is a integer number. So n could have been 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, plus minus 3, and so on. So this value is g, comma 0, z within bracket 0. This value is z within bracket ts, because it is defined for at t is equal to ts. This is defined at t is equal to 2ts. This is defined for t is equal to 3ts. So these samples are represented by g0, comma gts, comma g2ts, and so on. Now from these samples, if I want to develop one signal, which is nothing but the samples only, nothing but the collection of the samples only. That means if I want to represent a signal which is identified by this green colored one, so then this signal would have been represented by from the samples itself. So this signal is represented by GNTS into delta t minus nts for n belonging to minus infinity to plus infinity. And this is defined for all t. So g delta t is known as the ideal sampled signal. So delta t function is the unit impulse function, so which is defined for t is equal to 0 only. So as far as the formula of delta t is concerned, so delta t is equal to 1 for t is equal to 0 and 0 otherwise. 1 for t is equal to 0 and 0 otherwise. And 0 otherwise. So this function g delta t, which is represented by this green shades, so this is known as ideal sampled signal, which is nothing but the weighted delta and its shifted version. So what is delta t? Delta t is defined for t is equal to 0 only. So let me represent delta t over here. So t is equal to 0, so this is t axis. At t is equal to 0, delta t will be existing. The value is 1. This is delta t. In fact, this Dirac delta function can be approximated by means of a simple rectangle. Like I can also write this delta t is given by a by ts, where ts is ranging towards 0. So at the limit ts equal to 0, this value of delta t is approaching towards infinity. And for ts and for t is equal to 0, the delta t value will be equal to t not equal to 0, the delta t value is equal to 0. So delta t will be existing only for t is equal to 0, and that can be approximated by means of a rectangular function like this, whose area is constant, the Dirac delta function. If this is equal to, for example, if this is capital T, if this is capital T, and then this height will be A by capital T, so that the area of this particular pulse is always fixed at A, and this function, when approximated to T is equal to 0, then it is equivalent to a delta function. So when T is approaching towards 0, then this particular duration is almost close to 0 and the height becoming infinite. However, in digital signal processing, we prefer to refer delta function as a function which will be existing only for n is equal to 0, only for a particular sample. And for n is equal to 0, the delta value is given by 1. And however, for n not equal to 0, the value equal to 0. So this ideal sampled signal g delta t is represented by the weighted delta function and its shifted version. So G and Ts into delta T minus NTS. Now from the property of the Fourier transform, we know that the corresponding Fourier transform of G delta T, if I represent this by G delta F in the frequency domain, the Fourier transform property says that if the corresponding Fourier transform is G delta F, so that G delta F is equal to Fs times some m is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity G of F minus MFS. So this is the standard formula of Fourier transform, that if I have a signal GT for which the Fourier transform is GF, that means GT and GF, they are forming a Fourier transform pair. GT and GF. Then for the ideal sample signal G delta T, the corresponding Fourier transform, which is given by G delta F. So I may write this one, that G delta T and this G delta F, they are forming another Fourier transform pair. Then G delta F is related to GF by means of this particular formula. So this is obtained directly from the property of the Fourier transformation. Otherwise, you can also apply Fourier transformation on both sides of this particular equation. Then what you are getting? So we have got that GT, or rather G delta T, is represented by, we have found that G delta T is represented by summation n is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity GNTS into delta T minus NTS. Now, if you take the Fourier transform both sides of the equation, then right hand side, I'm computing later, the left hand side is given by G delta F. And this part is constant, GNTS is constant. It is no longer a function of time. So I can write GNTS only. And what about this delta T minus NTS? If you calculate the Fourier transformation, then it will become exponential. It will become exponential minus J twice pi F NTS. So from the property of Fourier transformation, you know, if there is a time shifting, then this is the corresponding change in the Fourier transformation. And for Fourier transformation, delta T is equal to 1. We know that Fourier transformation of delta T, this is the property of Fourier transform. Fourier transform delta T is equal to 1. And Fourier transform of some x t minus tau is nothing but e to the power minus J twice pi F tau multiplied with XF. So XF is the Fourier transform of XT. So considering this particular thing, we obtained that G delta F is given by G and Ts, which is essentially a constant term, and this exponential minus J twice pi F and Ts. So now we have already obtained that G delta F from the property of the Fourier transformation is given by Fs summation n is equal to minus to plus infinity G of F minus NFS. So obviously, since the left hand side of these two equations are being the same, so right hand side must also be the same, has to be the same. Now, if I assume that the signal GF is strictly band limited one, which means that GF is nothing but the Fourier transformation of the original signal GT, or the actual signal GT. Now, suppose that we have GT, which is a finite energy signal and time unlimited signal. So if the signal is time unlimited, then it should be band limited. So what do you mean by band limited signal? So in the frequency spectrum, suppose it looks something like that. For simplicity, I'm assuming a triangular kind of thing. So it is defined over minus W to plus W. So GF is defined over minus W to plus W. And beyond this range, GF is equal to zero. And this is zero otherwise. So this is the definition of the original signal GT in the frequency domain. The original signal was something like that, which was time unlimited, but finite energy signal. So since it is time unlimited, so it must be band limited. And the corresponding bandwidth is given by W only. So it is extending from minus W to plus W. Now, under this condition, if you would like to observe the variation of G delta F, how does it look like? So as you find, G delta F is nothing but the periodic repetition of the original signal GF. It is given by GF minus NFS for all n ranging from minus to plus infinity. So it's nothing but the periodic repetition of the signal GF and the period becoming FS only. So if this is the nature of the signal GF, then we can see that we are basically getting G delta F at our disposal, because after sampling, we are not getting GT. After sampling, we are getting G delta T. Once again, if I go back to the previous slide, the original signal was GT. But after sampling, the signal that we are getting over here is not GT, rather it is G delta T. So whenever we make any attempt to transfer this sampled signal G delta T over a medium, then obviously the signal which is at our hand is not GT, rather G delta T. So the corresponding Fourier transformation is nothing but G delta F. So at our hand, we have G delta F. Now, how does it look like, this G delta F? So G delta F is nothing but the periodic repetition of the signal GF. Obviously, there is a magnification by FS. So it will look something like that. And periodic repetition and infinite repetition. So it will be extended up to minus infinity in the left hand side, up to plus infinity in the right hand side, just like this. Now, if this value is like some constant k, then this value will be k times fs, as you understand, because there is a magnification by fs outside. So this is the frequency axis f, and this one is nothing but your g delta f. This is zero, this is w, this is minus w, and it is repeated with a repetition frequency of fs. So if it is zero over here, then this value is fs, this value will be twice fs. Similarly, in the left hand side, this value is minus fs, this value is minus 2 fs, and so on. Now we have, while transmitting the signal, this sampled signal, ideal sampled signal over the media, in our hand, we have G delta F. We don't have G delta T. We don't have GT. We have G delta T, or in frequency domain, we have G delta F. So either I can observe the signal from the property in the time domain or from the property in the frequency domain. So as soon as I transmit the signal G delta T instead of GT, instead of continuously varying signal, as soon as I make an attempt to transmit the sampled version only, the sequence of samples only, then I have g delta t for my transmission. So in the frequency domain, I have g delta f. But from the g delta f, I need to reconstruct the signal gt itself. I need to reconstruct the original signal, because in case of communication, as you know, all the information bearing signal, they are continuous in nature. For example, our voice signal, the audio signal, the speech signal, even the video signal. So all the signal, the image signal, so all the signals which we perceive by our organs, so all of them, even all the sensory signals, they are analog in nature. That means their variation can be regarded as a continuous variation. But for the sake of convenience, in order to use the technology in a much better way, we are using it, or we are transmitting it, by means of some digital means. So therefore, even if we have g delta f at our hand, but ultimately we need to get back gf. So if I just observe this particular pattern of g delta f, you may be confident that I can generate or I can develop gf from g delta f by using a low pass filter, which will only take out this part, because there is a periodic repetition. So only this part is of our importance, this part. So by means of some filter, if I can retrieve this part back, then only I can get it back. So gf is given by g delta f upon fs. Within this particular range, minus w to plus w. Or in other words, I can say that gf is equal to ts time g delta f. Now, obviously, there is a question that whether this retrieval is possible for all values of fs or not, because I have to ensure that this particular portion, I mean, this g delta f, which I have drawn already, this triangular shape, so it must not overlap with the succeeding or preceding waveforms. Or in other words, I can say that if this point, if this point w and this point fs minus w, if they are placed significantly apart, then only I can retrieve them properly. The boundary condition is that this value, as you must understand, that if this is fs, then this value must be fs minus w, and this value must be fs plus w. So the value of this w must be less than or equal to fs minus w. Otherwise, you cannot retrieve. This w must be either equal to fs minus w, or it should be less than fs minus w, so that there is a frequency spacing in between them. Otherwise, there will be an overlapping, and which will eventually distort the actual signal in the time domain as well. So this condition is given by fs greater than or equal to twice w. And this has been identified by the famous scientist Nyquist. And accordingly, this theorem is known as a Nyquist sampling theorem. So now we are in a position to state the Nyquist sampling theorem. So Nyquist sampling theorem states that if I have any finite energy signal and band limited signal, so band limited means the signal GT doesn't have any frequency component beyond W. It is strictly band limited. the signal GT doesn't have any frequency component beyond W. So it is existing between minus W to plus W. Now, if the signal is finite energy and if it is strictly band limited and with a bandwidth equal to W, or highest frequency component present in the signal is W, then the signal can be retrieved from its samples. The signal can be retrieved from its samples if and only if the sampling rate is chosen to be greater than or equal to twice the highest frequency present in the signal. Otherwise, what happens is, if I select any value of FS which is not greater than or equal to twice W, then there will be an overlapping between this spectrum with the consequent spectrum. And as a matter of fact, if I want to segregate that part by means of a low pass filter, then you will see that this part is, to some extent, it has been distorted. And I'll be discussing how is it distorted also if I select any value of FS which is not greater than or equal to twice W. But for the time being, let us assume that we are selecting a value of FS which is greater than or equal to twice W. So FS equal to 2W is the limiting value, and any value higher than 2W is also permissible. So under this condition, we can get it back. We can get back GF from G delta F. So GF is given by G delta F by FS. So if I select FS with twice W, so this is nothing but G delta F by 2W. So GF is given by G delta F by 2W. So once you get G delta F, so once again, let me write it down, the expression for G delta F, what you have already obtained. G delta F was written like, I just go back to this slide. This one is given by summation GNTS, then we have exponential minus J twice pi FNTS, where N is ranging from minus to plus infinity. That is the property, or that is the thing we have already discussed. Now, putting the value of FS to be 2W or TS to be 1 upon 2W, this expression is simplified to N equal to minus to plus infinity G of NTS, or you can also write G of N by 2W, because TS equal to 1 by 2W, into exponential minus J, then you can put the value of 2W over here. So then we have J pi F, J pi Fn by W. Once again, let me check. It was exponential minus J twice by FNTS. Exponential minus J twice by FNTS. So in place of TS, I have just put 1 by 2W. So 2 gets cancelled out. So it is a minus J pi FN by W. So this is the expression for G delta F, considering TS to be 1 by 2W. So once we get this G delta F, then I can get GF back using this particular formula, G delta F by 2W within the range minus W to plus W. So if I restrict the frequency operation within this minus W to plus W, then only GF and G delta F are related by means of this particular expression. Now, to get the original signal GT, what you need to do is we have to apply the inverse Fourier transformation. So GT can be obtained by Fourier inverse of GF, F inverse of GF. And GF can be already obtained from G delta F. So Fourier inverse of GF is given by, if I just write down the generic expression, so this is nothing but minus infinity to plus infinity GF exponential J twice pi FT DF. This is the formula of Fourier inverse Fourier transformation. GF exponential J twice pi FT DF. So now, GF is defined over minus W to plus W. So instead of writing the integration from minus infinity to plus infinity, I can easily make it like minus W to plus W. And GF is given by G delta F by 2W. So 1 by 2W, I can take it outside. 1 by 2W. And what is G delta F? G delta F is this much. So we have a summation sign over here. N goes from minus to plus infinity gn by 2w. Then I should write exponential j pi fn by w. Then exponential j twice pi ft df. So since the signal GT is itself finite energy signal, so I can always interchange the order of summation and integration. So 1 by 2W, and the integration is performed over F. So this G of N by 2W has nothing to do with F. So I can take it outside. No problem, because this is not a function of F, this G of N by 2W. Then I'll apply the integration minus W to plus W exponential. If I take it like J twice pi F common, then it becomes T minus N by 2W. Let's take it e to the power J twice pi FT, and then it becomes, oh, there is a minus sign over here. I just forgot to mention. There is a minus sign, so it should be minus over here. Yeah, now it is okay. E to the power j 2w 22 gets cancelled out. E to the power minus j pi fn by w. Then we have df over here. So let me go to the next slide. So we get GT is given by 1 by 2W. Then we have the summation N going from minus to plus infinity G of N by 2W. Let me write it down, the expression once again. Minus W to plus W exponential J twice pi F T minus N by 2W DF. So that particular integration is represented by N going from minus to plus infinity G of N by 2W. Then I can write like this. Exponential J twice pi F T minus N by 2W. So there will be minus W2 plus W over here. And in the denominator, we should have J twice pi T minus N by 2W. If you put the value over here, so 1 by 2W, N going from minus to plus infinity, G of N by 2W, then we have exponential J twice pi W T minus N. Minus exponential minus J twice pi W T minus N. Divided by J into twice pi W T minus N. If I just multiply, so this 2W will not be there. If I multiply this 2W over here, I'm just multiplying this 2W with this one. So e to the power j, so that is becoming over here, and j times 2 pi, if I multiply this with, so I think 1 by 2 will be there only. So only W will be, rather, I think it is better to keep it as it is. Rather keep it as it is. J 2 pi T minus N by 2W. So that could have been simplified to some extent, this expression. We know that e to the power jx minus e to the power minus jx by 2j is nothing but sine x. So if I just invoke that formula, then e to the power j 2 pi w t minus n minus e to the power minus j 2 pi w t minus n by 2j. So 2j I can take it. So then it becomes n going from minus to plus infinity g of n by 2w. Then I should write sine of, so e to the power jx. So what is that? I think I have missed a pi over here. 2 pi wt minus, if I multiply this with n by 2w, so I believe, yeah. Two W, so I have missed a pi over here. So there will be pi. So sine of 2 pi So sine of 2 pi wt minus n pi. Sine of 2 pi wt minus n pi. By 2j, so 2j I have taken. So what is left? 2j I have already taken. So what is left? I have 2 pi wt minus then it is multiplied. So n pi. So ultimately, I'm getting the formula like this. Sine of 2 pi wt minus n pi divided by 2 pi wt minus n pi. So another formula I would like to invoke. Sine pi x by pi x, this formula, which is given by sine cx, sine c function. So if I invoke that formula, then it is coming like g of n by 2w into sine c of 2wt minus n, and that is for all t. So ultimately, we are getting a formula like this. So after a little bit of mathematics, what we have ultimately obtained is the gt, the original signal which you want to retrieve at the receiving end from its samples, can be represented by a summation g of n by 2w into sine c function with an argument of 2wt minus n for all t. That means if I know the sample value, if I know the g of n by 2w, so these are nothing but the samples taken at an uniform interval of fs samples per second. That means the difference between two consecutive samples in the time domain is only ts. Now, if the samples are given to us, if I can have the samples at our disposal, then by using a sine c type of interpolation function, so sine c function, sine function, I'll be discussing what does it look, how does it look like. Using this interpolation function and using those samples, I can actually get the signal gt. So it is always possible to retrieve the signal gt from its sample version if and only if the samples are taken at an interval which is specified by Nyquist sampling rate, Nyquist sampling theorem. So now this particular formula has been established. So we can say that if I just go back to this slide once again, so we can say that if I want to convey the signal gt through a transmission medium, and if I want to do that by means of sending those samples, not the exact values, I mean not the all the values of gt, which is specified for all the values of t, if I want to represent the signal gt by means of its sampled version, ideal sampled version g delta t, then in order to get the original signal back, I need to perform two operations. First of all, at the very beginning, what I need to do is I have to put the sampled signal, I have to put the sampled signal through a low pass filter, which will extract this particular band from the periodic spectrum. So I have sent g delta t through the channel. So in the frequency domain, I am basically sending, or I am basically interested about this g delta f. And this g delta f is nothing but the periodic repetition of the signal gf. So therefore, in order to obtain the gf back from g delta f, first of all, I need to have a low pass filter which will extract this spectrum out of this entire spectrum. And once we get this spectrum back by virtue of this equation, then I know that if I follow this particular formula of interpolation, then from the samples itself, we can get back the original signal gt. However, there are few requirements, stringent requirements, that we must not forget at this particular juncture. So let me tell you what are the stringent requirements. First of all, this entire analysis has been carried out by considering the fact that the sampling has been performed at a rate equal to 2w. So that's why I have used fs is equal to twice w. But what happens if I select the value of fs to be exactly equal to 2w? Before that, let me tell you that initially I have told you that the signal gt is finite energy. So these are the two attributes of GT, the finite energy. And because of the finite energy signal, the change of this operation, summation and integration, the order of operation has been changed over here. So this is only possible over here. I have made this corresponding change. This is only possible if GT is of finite energy. And second condition on GT was that it was time unlimited. So I have mentioned that GT is defined for time unlimited. So GT is defined for all T. So GT is defined for all T. GT is defined for all T. That means it is time unlimited. And for which, if a signal is time unlimited, then it should be band limited. So that is the property. Any signal which is time unlimited, it must be band limited. A pure sinusoidal signal which is existing for all T, a pure sinusoidal signal, for example, if I have a pure sinusoidal signal like this, which is defined for all T, ranging from minus to plus infinity, then it is having a single frequency, that is Fs, given by 1 upon Ts. Now, unfortunately or fortunately, all the practical signals, they are not time unlimited. If I say, if I consider a voice signal or audio signal or any speech signal, so all of them are time limited signal. Maybe it will be, say, a duration of 5 seconds or 10 seconds or 20 seconds or 5 minutes or 10 minutes, even say 1 hour, but it should be time limited signal. So any signal which is time unlimited, it must be band limited, and any signal which is time limited must be band unlimited. So for example, if I consider speech of, say, a speech signal like this, which is time limited between say T0 to T1, then in the frequency domain, it must be band unlimited. It looks something like that. In the frequency domain, if I just look at the, so this is the time, T versus some speech signal, say T versus GT, which is defined about from this point to that point. Then the frequency domain, GT versus GF versus F, it should be band unlimited. That means beyond a certain frequency, okay, there will be certain frequency components. The values are there. Suppose this is 3.4 kilohertz or so, but beyond this 3.4 kilohertz, some insignificant frequency component is also present. So if the signal is band unlimited, that means the bandwidth is very large. Then I cannot go by the Nyquist sampling theorem, because Nyquist sampling theorem is established on the fact that the corresponding signal GT is band limited and the bandwidth is W. Then only I can select a value of sampling rate which is greater than or equal to twice W. Now, under the condition when the signal GF itself is band unlimited, then obviously the FS should be very large, the sampling rate, and which is impractical in nature. So that's why for any practical signal which is time limited or band unlimited, so for any practical signal, what is done? The signal GT is passed through a filter, a low pass filter, which is known as anti-aliasing filter. For the time being, just understand what is meant by the low pass filter. The signal GT is passed through a low pass filter so that ultimately the signal is becoming band limited. So these frequency components, which are insignificant in the spectrum, so these frequency components are, to some extent, they are suppressed. And we are getting a signal G delta T, which is essentially time limited. So it looks something like that. It looks something like that. If this is F, then this is G of delta F. No, not a delta F, rather G of WF. As far as our notation is concerned, this should be G of WF. That means it is time limited. Time limited. So band unlimited. Now we are making the band limited by passing it through a low pass filter, G delta GWF. And these values, suppose this is W. So once it becomes band limited, now we can apply the Nyquist sampling theorem. But even if we apply the Nyquist sampling theorem, then you'll see that in the spectrum of G delta F, How does it look like? This is the spectrum of the delta f, which is nothing but the periodic repetition of the original spectrum gf. So since f is equal to twice w, so these are the spectrum. They are repeated like this over here as well. This point is w, and this point is fs minus w, same point. So this is fs. This is twice fs. So fs minus w is chosen to be equal to w, or fs equal to w. That means these two points being the same. Now, in order to get the actual spectrum from this g delta f, so this is the spectrum of g delta f, what I need to do, I have to place a low-pass filter which will extract. I have to place a low-pass filter which will extract this band. So low-pass filter will look something like that. It will extract this band and it will suppress the other frequency component. But under this condition, when f is equal to w, it is very difficult to design a low-pass filter for which the transition band is so sharp. A brick wall kind of transition from the pass band to the stop band. It is very difficult to achieve for a low-pass filter. So that's why, to impose some practical operational convenience, the sampling rate is chosen to be higher than the minimum sampling rate specified. Now, if this condition is true, that fs is greater than or equal to twice w, then in the spectrum of g delta f, it looks something like that. So this is the one band, this is the other band, just like this. They are uniformly spaced with a repetition frequency of fs. So now I can select the band using a low-pass filter for which the transition band is little bit flatter. So flatter transition band is allowed. So which helps us to design the corresponding low-pass filter with much more flexibility. So these are the some practical limitations of any finite energy signal. First of all, the signal must be time. It is time limited, so it is band unlimited. So before passing it through a media, through a channel, first of all, we need to make sure that the signal becomes band limited by means of low-pass filter. And this low-pass filter is known as an anti-aliasing filter. Now, if this is not done, then what happens? I am just trying to explain by means of diagram. The aliasing part, which I have already mentioned, suppose this is the signal, actual spectrum of the signal GT. Now, if I want to draw the G delta F, that means the periodic repeated version, considering the fact that I am now just violating the Nyquist sampling theorem, that means Fs is chosen to be less than 2W. If this condition has been established over here, then what happens after Fs? So this is at zero. Then the next value, next sample, next spectrum is placed at a value of Fs which is less than 2W. So as a matter of fact, they have been overlapping like this between the successive spectrum. So the higher frequency component of the original signal seemingly look like the lower frequency component in its sampled version. So there is some overlapping. So ultimately, if I just look at the overall spectrum, how does it look like? Then the overall spectrum will look something like that. So this is F. This one is G delta F. So we can have a spectrum like this. So even if we make any attempt to extract this band by using a low pass filter over here, by placing a low pass filter over here, even if I make any attempt to extract the band, but remember, there is an overlapping takes place. The lower frequency component, I mean the higher frequency component of one band is getting overlapped. And as a matter of fact, the higher frequency component of this spectrum G delta F will be somewhat distorted. And this effect is known as the aliasing effect. So in order to get rid of this aliasing effect, what is done? The signal itself, the original signal GT itself, is passed through a low pass filter to ensure that any frequency component which is higher than W is suppressed, and which will help us to fix up the value of the Nyquist sampling rate, that is equal to greater than or equal to 2W. So that low pass filter is known as, this low pass filter is known as also anti-aliasing filter. This is known as anti-aliasing filter, which is placed at the transmitter end. So this anti-aliasing filter is placed in the transmitter end. And to retrieve the signal back, to retrieve the signal GF back from G delta F, another low pass filter is present in the receiver side. And that filter is known as the reconstruction filter, which is also low pass in nature, but the name is different depending upon their attributes. In the transmitting side, the name of the low pass filter is anti-aliasing filter, which will prohibit any type of aliasing effect to take place in the transmitting end. So that's why the name is anti-aliasing. And the receiver side, another low pass filter is there, which will be used to extract GF back from G delta F. That means it will try to reconstruct the signal, original signal from the sampled version. So that's why the low pass filter, which is present in the receiver side, is known as the reconstruction filter. So there are two different low pass filter, but the purpose are different: anti-aliasing filter and the reconstruction filter. Now, after the sampling process is over, so at the end of sampling process, what we have at our disposal is a sequence of samples. So instead of having GT, so original signal was like that. That was original signal. Now, instead of having this original signal, now I have the corresponding samples only, which is represented by G delta T. So this is T and this one is G delta T. Now, instead of using GT as the information bearing signal, now one can use the G delta T as an information bearing signal, considering the fact that G delta T will be having the same effect as was with GT. Now, as I was mentioning initially, in case of pulse modulation, either the amplitude of the pulse or the duration of the pulse or the position of the pulse might be varied in accordance with the information bearing signal. Now, one such important and very popular one is known as pulse amplitude modulation. As I've already mentioned, pulse amplitude modulation. It's a kind of analog pulse modulation scheme. Pulse amplitude modulation, or PAM in short. Let me discuss it very briefly. Now, actually, we are having a signal like this. I'm just representing the signal by means of a dotted line. Any arbitrary shape signal, which looks something like that. It can be negative as well. For the sake of simplicity, I am representing in the positive direction only. It can be negative as well. So this is the signal, MT, the message signal. Now, depending upon the sample value of the message signal, placed at some previously specified sampling interval, now the pulse amplitude is modified. So initially, the pulse trend looks something like that. This is the pulse trend. Now, here we find that the amplitude of the pulse is remaining constant. Let it be A. So the pulse amplitude is remaining constant, A. So this pulse trend will be used as a carrier signal to transmit the information from the one end to the other end. And the information is transmitted by changing the amplitude of this pulse. And remember that this amplitude modulation will take place only at specified time interval. So let me represent them over here graphically. How does it look like? Suppose these blue signals are the corresponding PAM signals. As you find that this is nothing but a series of pulses, but the amplitude of the pulse is not constant. Rather, it varies with the amplitude of the sampled message signal. So the pulse amplitude is not constant. It varies continuously. And moreover, the samples, if you just look it properly, the peak of the pulse is remaining flat. Peak of the pulse is remaining flat. And this is known as a flat top sampling. But this value is dependent upon these values. I mean, this value, then this value, then this value. So this top, this sample value. So it is dependent upon the message signal amplitude, just like this. Now, if I represent this signal by means of ST. So ST is the PAM signal, pulse amplitude modulated signal, PAM signal. So you must understand that ST and MT, they are not being the same. So I can represent this ST as, this can be mathematically represented by this, M NTS into H of T minus NTS. So I'm going to explain each of these terms for N varying from minus to plus infinity. Once again, I'm assuming that this MT is existing for all values of T. So ST, this blue colored signal, is the PAM signal, which is represented by M of NTS into H of T minus NTS. What is H of T of T minus NTS? This is nothing but the shifted version of HT. And how is HT defined? So HT looks something like that. HT looks something like that. This is small t, this is HT. Graphically, HT looks something like that. That means HT is equal to 1 for 0 less than t less than capital T. This is equal to half for t is equal to 0. I can take t greater than equal to t, no problem, and 0 otherwise. So that means a pulse signal is represented by means of HT, which is defined only from 0 to t, and there is a change of value of HT at t is equal to 0. So that's why there is a discontinuity, and the value is given by half at t is equal to 0, and otherwise the value is 1 within that range, 0 to capital T. Or you can also write like HT is equal to half for t is equal to 0 and t is equal to capital T is equal to 2t and so, and HT is equal to 0 otherwise. So this sample, this value is nothing but m of 0 multiplied with HT. This signal can be represented by m of 0 multiplied with HT. This signal is nothing but m of TS into HT minus TS. This is m of 2TS into HT minus 2TS. This is m of 3TS into HT minus 3TS, and so on. So I can mention the corresponding time over here. So this is TS. This value is 2TS. I mean, this value, this is 2TS, this is TS, this is 3TS, and so on. And this difference is capital T. This is the pulse duration. So I am making the pulse duration constant. Pulse duration is fixed, but the pulse amplitude is modified. So ST is represented by m of NTS multiplied with h of T minus NTS. So this is the basic notion of a pulse amplitude modulation scheme. Now you can easily verify that if I represent m delta t in this fashion, that m delta t is nothing but m nts into delta t minus nts, that means the ideal sample signal for n ranging from minus to plus infinity. If m delta t looks something like that, m nts into delta t minus nts, then you can easily verify that the convolution between m delta t and ht, if I perform the convolution operation between these two signal, m delta t and ht, then you will be getting what is known by st. So m delta t I have already provided over here. HT is also given. Now, if you perform this continuous level convolution between m delta t and HT, you will find that this is given by S of T. Now, let me invoke another important property of Fourier transform, that the convolution in the natural time domain is equivalent to multiplication in the frequency domain. So, in the frequency domain, if I look the spectrum, it will be nothing but SF is given by M delta F into HF. So M delta F into HF. This is the property. This is the property of a Fourier transform. If there are two signals, if they're convolved in the natural time domain, so in the frequency domain, they are multiplied. So SF is given by M delta F into H of F. You can readily verify this particular expression, whether this is true or not. So SF is given by M delta F into HF. Now, how M delta F is related to MF? You know that the original signal was MT and the ideal sampled signal was M delta T. So therefore, their Fourier transform are related by means of this formula, as we have already established. This M delta F is nothing but Fs summation n going from minus to plus infinity, m of f minus mfs, nfs. So this is the relation between mf and m delta f. And already we have established that sf, the signal, the PAM signal, which you want to transmit over a channel, is given by m delta f multiplied with hf. So this is nothing but fs, summation going from n minus to plus infinity, m of f minus mf nfs into hf. So once again, to get the original signal mt back in the natural domain is equivalent to getting the signal mf back in the frequency domain. So if I observe this sf over a window from minus w to plus w, if I observe it over a window, once again I have to restrict that the signal mf or the signal mt is band limited. Then sf can be written like this: fs time mf into hf over a period from minus w to plus w, w being the bandwidth. So fs is a constant term, it's a constant multiplication, so it will not hamper the actual spectrum of the original signal mf. But remember, apart from fs, there is another term hf associated with this sf. So if the signal is something like that in the natural domain, if the signal is something like that, it is 1, it's ht, I mean, this is ht in the natural domain. The frequency domain, it will take a look of a sinc function. Sinc function sin c ft. Let me once again draw this sinc function. How does it look like, sinc function in the frequency domain? Just like this. So this is in the frequency domain f, and this one is hf. So these values are 1 by t, this is 2 by t, and so on. This is minus 1 by t, and so on. So this function is nothing but hf, is given by sin c of ft. So the original signal mf is distorted by means of this hf. So as a matter of fact, if I want to get back the original signal mf back from the sf, then I need to add one block in cascade with sf, and that block is known as the equalizer block. So you have a PAM signal, you have got a PAM signal in the receiver side. The PAM signal is received. So PAM signal means you have SF over here. In the frequency domain, PAM signal means you have SF, and which is given by FS time G delta F. So I have over here mentioned M delta F. So let it be M delta F. So M delta F into HF, or in other words, let me start from the beginning. So this ST is nothing but the convolution of the two signal M delta T and HT. So in the frequency domain, this is nothing but M delta F into HF. What is M delta F? M delta F is nothing but FS times n going from minus to plus infinity. M of f minus nfs multiplied with hf. So I need to get back mf from this entire PAM signal. So first of all, from this periodic repetition of the spectrum, I need to get this mf. So all the other variations will be discarded, and that is done using a reconstruction filter using an LPF at the very beginning. That is needed. Now, at the output of the LPF, you will be getting the signal, which is given by fs times mf times hf. So all the other repeated values like m of f minus fs, m of f minus 2fs, and m of f minus 3fs, they are discarded at the output of the low pass filter. And if I want to get back mf from this PAM signal, then I need to pass it through an equalizer. I need to pass it through an equalizer whose system function is given by 1 upon HF. Then at the output of the equalizer, you will be getting FS times NF. So we are not at all concerned about this FS because this is a constant term. So if the spectrum is multiplied by a constant term, so it doesn't make any difference. But this, if the spectrum is multiplied by some another spectrum, just by HF, then in order to retrieve the original signal back, I need to connect one equalizer, which will equalize all the attributes of the channel or all the attributes which have been already performed by means of this 1 by HF. So ultimately, we are getting this FS time MF at the output of this receiver block. So once you get this MF, so just by using the Fourier inverse Fourier transform, you can get back MT, the original signal. But however, the transmission of signal using this pulse amplitude modulation is having some serious implication, is having some serious difficulties, in the sense that whenever we are making any attempt to transmit this information by means of those pulses, so they will basically restrict the maximum allowable channel bandwidth. Because we know, while we make any attempt to transmit this information by means of a pulse like this in this particular way, then the duration of the pulse has something to say about the bandwidth requirement of the transmitted signal. If we make this band, if we make this transition width, this TS, if this transmission width is reduced to some extent, then the bandwidth requirement will be very large. So as a matter of fact, this pulse amplitude modulation is not at all very much effective for long length communication. However, for a time division multiplexing scheme, we can have this type of pulse amplitude modulation to some extent. Otherwise, this fluctuation over here, I mean, this duration to some extent controls the bandwidth requirement of the transmitted signal. And moreover, here we have considered a flat top kind of sampling. That means this is remaining constant throughout. So that can be obtained through a sample and hold circuit. But for natural sampling, what is expected is, so this is the pulse amplitude modulation using a flat top kind of sampling. So that's why I have written like this, H of T minus NTS. But for natural sampling, if I consider natural sampling, then the peak of the pulse, I mean, it will not be constant, rather it will be changed accordingly for actual sampling, I mean the natural sampling. So this is the natural sampling. So in which case, this is not at all constant. Peak of the pulse is not flat. Rather, it will vary in accordance with the signal amplitude, just like this. So it is having some serious implication. Now, So today we have discussed about a few essential attributes of the transmitter and receiver block of any digital communication system. More specifically, we have talked about the essential features of any communication environment, then the need of the sampling process, the utility, and we have established the Nike sampling theorem, the statement, and the mathematical derivations. And ultimately, I have made some deliberation on the pulse amplitude modulation and some mathematical attributes related to this pulse amplitude modulation and few of the limitations pertaining to this pulse amplitude modulation. Now with this, let me stop today's discussion.